Good morning. My name is Peter Eavis. I'm a reporter at the New York Times. I cover finance, Wall Street, bank regulation. We had some big news today. Does anyone know what happened this morning? That's right, yeah. So, yeah, so the living wills are these resolvability plans that you have to have now to make sure that you're simple enough to wind down in a bankruptcy. And we can talk about whether that would ever happen in real life. I'm sure a lot of... No? You can't hear me?
Yeah.
So that happened today, so we have news, something to actually talk about, which is great. I'm excited to hear what these guys have to say. I've spoken to Ed over the years about financial regulation, and I'm glad to be here. So I think what we're going to do is just let... Is it each person speaks for an equal amount of time? Yeah? No one gets more?
Part where you have 20 minutes? Half an hour.
Yeah, I've already done my work for that. I already filed a story on the living wills. It's 8 o'clock this morning, so I'm going to let these guys talk now. Thank you. Citigroup.
Yeah.
Flying colors.
Well, they know it, because they know no one is going to close them. Well, you know, I'm Ed Kane from Boston College, and many people have talked about their relationship to High. When High's career, when I first met it, was he organized the Commission on Money and Credit Research, and he published a study which was the forerunner of his later 1967 study, and I had the privilege of reviewing for the AER, the American Economic Review, the volume in which his piece occurred. And I was especially impressed with two ideas he had, which he developed later, and they're very interesting even today. One is the probability of financial crisis increases with the duration of booms. So the idea that we had this long moderation actually set us up with a lot of poison in the system that we weren't getting rid of. So it really raises questions about stabilization policy generally. And secondly, he said the truly serious recessions only occur when expenditure contraction is reinforced by financial difficulties. So those were the root ideas that he later went on to develop. We'll just get rid of this. Into his later and more famous work. Anyway, I'm grateful to the organizers, Dimitri especially, and you can see the title is unusual in that it focuses on culture. And I'm an economist studying culture, but I'm studying culture at an organization, the central bank, that I've devoted over 50 years to studying and working for various pieces. So I think of myself as a cultural anthropologist. So my talk is built around the idea, first of all, that regulation is a cat and mouse game, a game of pursuit. Only, and the odd thing is that in this game, it's the regulated institutions, the mega banks in particular, that are the cats. They're extremely strong, have much more resources, and actually can constrain the resources that the regulators have. And I employ this predominant model of culture from Edgar Schein of MIT, and this contrasts with models of culture most other economists use, which come out of business organizations. He's observed the cultures inside a business, the executive cultures, and I'll give you a model of that. Then finally, in addition, I use six cartoons to illustrate how ethical defects in the executive cultures feed and intensify modern crises. So I think that these ethical problems, we've got to come back to. Economists tried for years to say how far you can go with no ethical values. Well, we've gone too far. and we've got to address this. So my explanation focuses on these norms in mega banking, that is what they're trying to do, and in government executive cultures. And my point is that they squeeze out moral concepts of right and wrong, simple ideas of right and wrong, and support waves of crime, which I call theft by safety net. So let's start out with the idea of what is a model. Many of you would think a model is some sort of set of mathematical equations. But at a more fundamental level, it's a logical system that defines a set of variables and analyzes how they interact. It doesn't have to be mathy. And the conceptual distinctions that underlie your decision of what variables to include has to be insightful. And the more insightful it is, the more you can get out of the model. So, okay, how do we model a corporation's character, that is, the correspondence to a person's character or culture? So this Edgar Schein, he has three components to his model. And I think this is a very important slide. Try to understand this because it's so really so brilliant. The first idea is that every organization has espoused goals and strategies for achieving them. This is true of central banks, regulators, mega bankers. And then there are what he calls artifacts, things we can observe and that the organization uses. And we have things like buildings, staff, equipment, procedures, technology. Boy Scout rules and policy instruments. All of these are things you can observe. And then you have, what's really important, are the deeply embedded behavioral norms and various shared assumptions or beliefs about how to behave in different circumstances. And I'm saying that's where we really have a problem with the central bank. And not just in this country, but around the world. So these are unspoken but very resilient norms and assumptions. The French use the term le non-dit, the unspoken, that nobody speaks about these. And these often conflict with the espoused goals. And I'll try to make that clear as I go along. So the conflict between the regulatory mission and the unspoken norms can be tremendous. Here's the idea that the mission is clear. Prudential regulators want to protect society from various things. One, dangerous risk-taking in the banking system and for that matter, even in driving. And capital shortages and loss concealment at these mega banks. But they face three strong buts. The first is that mega banks are at war with foreign mega banks. So this creates a sort of duty to be helpful, not to handicap these banks in competing with foreign party. Second, the regulators and politicians and the industry want a disclosure regime that actually involves a lot of deception and concealment because they want to be able to limit the possibilities of runs and meltdowns. And so this makes it hard for outsiders, even regulators, to observe adverse information as growing losses in a timely manner. You can think of this right now with respect to the problems with oil loans. We don't really have a way of surfacing which of the mega banks might have been hurt by this. Third, regulators are short timers. Even if they stay a long time, they know that if the administration changes or they become scapegoats for some problem, they'll be gone. So that brings me to my first cartoon, illustrating this point about the cat and mouse game. But in this game, the cat isn't trying to eat the mouse. It's trying to get some cream, which are basically subsidies to tail risk, to risking the ruin of the firm. And they are very under-equipped. You see this regulator simply waving his finger, saying, no, don't try to get this cream that I'm guarding. And you see the shadow of the mega bank, the cat. So you see how very large and much more powerful that he is. All right, now, the executive cultures in mega banking, of course, is profit maximization. And I maintain that in government, it's blame avoidance. You don't want to be blamed for anything. So there's little room for morality per se. And I'll make this clear by following this these things which I've worked out. Realistically, mega bank executives wrestle every day with three issues. One, what is profitable for our firm to do? What will the supervisors let me get away with? How can we defend and expand these opportunities? Now, legality under number two is as close as we get to right and wrong. Well, what kind of a standard is legality? Does it have a strong moral justification? Look at this. Apartheid was legal. Holocaust was legal. Slavery was legal. Colonialism was legal. Legality is a matter of power, not morality. So let me go back to the slide. Let's say, could we improve these questions? This is what I'm at the heart of my work. I think we could if we replace the is in the first appearance of the verb. So we say, what should our firm do? What should the supervisors let us get away with? What should we do to defend and expand these profit-making opportunities? It's very different from what can we do, what is possible. We put some moral constraints on our behavior. So just to underscore this in a different way, it's instinctive for firms to manage accounting measures of performance, cooking their books to some extent, to show more profits maybe than they had, certainly to hide losses they're developing. And culture and character aren't really managed in most cases directly or even thought about as something to manage. So I say that these cycles of scandal, cover-up, and denial that firms go through, and government agencies as well. So stage one is where they want to be all the time. Again, this would be the tranquility idea that Minsky emphasized. You say, what are you talking about? Our staff are good people doing great things. That's what we want to be able to say all the time. And then at some point within the firm, at least, they say, maybe we have a few problems, but we can cover these up, and it would damage our reputation if we admitted them to outsiders. Well, eventually, the cover-up fails if the losses are big enough and problems are big enough. And then we get to stage four, which is really the beginning of, it gets us back to stage one. At last, our critics have moved on. We can go back to doing great things. So, now, I'm only going to emphasize here two points of this central bank. First, their self-image. And I mean, this is, again, close observation of many central bankers in many countries even. They see themselves as a noble and unfairly scapegoated team of heroes who are repeatedly assigned overambitious goals by cynical politicians. And the previous panel discussed that to some extent. And then I want to move down to the last point there about the short time horizon. Central banks perennially focus on achieving demonstrable short-term results. That's how we got into all this focus about a quarter basis point move in interest rates. They're attracted to policies even though they know they have bad long-term effects. And the main one of this is the idea of emergency loans for insolvent banks rather than confronting the problems at these banks. So performance norms for crisis management illustrate these long-held assumptions about how regulators in advanced countries prefer to deal with megabank distress. Megabanks get in trouble. What do? Well, the first thing is you step up, you try to calm the markets. And that says it's okay to mischaracterize the character of a zombie firm's distress as a liquidity problem, because that will help to stop a run or meltdown, at least again in the short run. And they have a preference for completely rescuing the creditors of institutions that are difficult to unwind or sell off. So smaller institutions they can act upon, but the bigger ones are allowed to limp along as zombies. Now, the European Union is purporting to change all this, that they're going to have bail-in policies, but you know they can't do that for countries like Italy, France. They can do it for Cyprus, but you know they're fooling themselves, and we shouldn't let them fool us. So my working hypothesis is that these two norms, of course, undermine stability, and that this rescue mentality is part of the non-public character of central bank regulatory cultures around the world. Now, I don't know how many of you, I've had a few friends that are firemen, and you know, you can think of central bankers coming into a crisis as firemen or fire persons, if you prefer. And what they do is they rescue the inhabitants, but they don't put out the embers of the fire. They leave it there as a threat to flame up again. And that's the difference of the firemen are determined to have ended the source of further flames. So no matter how much the weapons of prudential regulation are enhanced after a crisis, where we create new bail-in powers, including these living wills, unless these anti-egalitarian or elitist norms are confronted and modified, mega banks and their creditors are going to foster weakness and transparency and data quality that let them play successive games of hide and seek during the booms, like right now, hiding whatever exposures they have to oil. And they play hide and seek during the booms, and then they play chicken in the bust. And the people who lose the game of chicken, the central bankers, paint themselves as heroes for letting these schemes go on. So the pretense and unequal power are very much part of the game. That we're re-equipping central bankers with a quiver of sticks, enhanced prudential regulation, they call it. So they refuse during pre-crisis and post-crisis periods to admit that the prospect of living will, stress tests, and capital and liquidity constraints cannot exert long-lasting discipline on the cat-quick megabanks that roam their countries. That is to say, you can put the rules in place, but as long as we say it's okay to get around the rules, they'll find ways to get around the rules. That's where we get back to, as I say, morality. So in most countries, the reforms right now that have put forward are being artfully and insidiously delayed, lobbied down, and neutralized by all kinds of capital relief trading activity. The things that especially in Britain, you can see Britain had some very sensible reforms, even passed a law that was going to create a crime of leading a very big firm into bankruptcy, bank, and that people would have had to defend themselves to show that they had done everything to make it, to help the firm, to stop regulatory breaches. Now, so in the meantime, the various mega banks in the US and Europe are doing what this next cartoon shows. They're lapping up subsidies with the understanding that somewhere down the line there's going to be some tougher rules. And again, I don't know how many of you know this, but dairy cattle today, if there's a feed, they are fed with machines, and a machine breaks down, they will eat themselves to death. Because you know, when you were foraging in the desert for food, you could never get enough, so there was no curbing of your appetite. It's not built in. And I believe that several of these banks will, again, eat themselves to death. So where does this trough of subsidies come from? Well, from the zero haircut policies of insolvency resolution and the failure to actually prosecute individuals for reckless behavior. So in crisis, the souring of these mega bank tail risks push the central banks in this game of chicken, but they always chicken out. Now, why do they chicken out? They fear having a meltdown on their watch. Giant firms are economically, politically, and administratively difficult to unwind, so it's a huge problem. And they don't want to slam any revolving doors, especially the speaking fees, which are a very good way of paying people off. So, cultural norms, why are these cultural norms resilient? Well, because they are communicated by seeing what behaviors lead to advancement at the central bank. Rising in any hierarchy depends on the ability to receive and conform to behavioral norms that are drilled into newbies. So my paper identifies six behavioral norms. I just want to go through the first four here. One is essentially a mercantilist norm of partiality and clientele service to protect the client's earning powers. So there's many ways this is done, limiting entry being one. Secondly, mercy and benefit of the doubt norms that dictate sympathy, help, and lean and discipline for distressed client firms and their creditors virtually at all times. Third, loss concealment norms, again, because of an ingrained fear of runs and meltdowns, that demand that regulators not only hold adverse client information confidential, but that they misrepresent this information when they think it'll promote the common good. How many times have regulators said, oh, there's really no problem with that bank, don't worry about it, and you know, two weeks, a month later, they are taking serious action against it. And finally, and this I can't emphasize enough, reluctance to prosecute high-ranking bankers for reckless behavior. I want you to think about reckless driving, right? We don't have to prove it. Some of them have to prove that he knew that driving 120 miles an hour on a snow-covered road was dangerous. We assume he ought to know, he should know. If we're paying somebody $100 million to run a bank, he should know the risks and he should understand if the survival of the firm has been put on the line. So this brings me to my third and cruelest cartoon, that I think of the safety net as a criminalizable racket. And if it's criminalizable, why don't we criminalize it? So the idea is that people are trying to say that artful exploitation of the safety net is creative, it's not inevitable moral hazard in my mind, but an outlawable form of theft. And here we see this lethal bully, crime pin, with a gun on the government official who's dutifully, instead of trying to arrest the guy with the gun, is picking the pocket of a hapless taxpayer to support the business of the bully. So this might be my most important point if I get you to understand this, that part of the deception is to call bailouts loans and insurance payments rather than loss-absorbing equity funding. The point being, the moral obligations that go with these three different contracts are very different. So think of us as taxpayers as having a position that if a firm gets in great trouble, we absorb their losses. This is, of course, the mega banks. Look how inferior that is to the position of the stockholders in the same firm. Taxpayers can't trade their positions away except by going to another country. Downside liability is not contraction limited, which is the way ordinary stockholders face it, but the upside gain is. You have unlimited downward liability if the officials refuse to bring the firm under control. Taxpayer positions are poorly compensated and carry no procedure or disclosure safeguards, and again, by putting new things on the table, we can get even more trouble. Now, so what are the policy recommendations that come out of this? Well, fairness is really the nominal goal of all law. And what I do in the paper, and I don't want to get too much into it here, is to use Immanuel Kant's concept of fairness to establish that megabanks and central banks are abusing taxpayers. They use them as means to enrich themselves. And the taxpayers are coerced suppliers of loss-absorbing equity funding. It's not a loan, it's not an insurance payment, it's a taxpayer put, and the loss-limiting side of the contract is not exercised. So I think governments have a duty to acknowledge that and to make company law explicitly recognize and protect taxpayers' interests in crisis management policy. That company law has to change. I don't think it's going to change in my lifetime. It may not change in yours. But it has to change because it is simply unfair and it's going to get worse and worse. And at some point, it'll be understood. Now, the key point is understanding tail risk, like speed of a car, is measurable, although, albeit imperfectly, and the reckless pursuit of tail risk by mega bankers resembles reckless driving. And reckless driving causes problems for other people, not just for the person driving recklessly. The harm this business model visits on the citizenry implies the need for laws, fiduciary law, by which to change the incentives by identifying and penalizing extreme recklessness and prosecuting managers who intentionally, or at least should have known, what they were doing, and that they should also go after regulators who tolerate this behavior. I can tell you some stories of one regulator in particular who was treated as, even though he had cooked the books for a big SNL, was thought to be wounded in action and allowed to retire with his full pension and so on. So what we need to do is create a reasonable burden of proof and an obligation to prosecute. So these new laws should include presumptive tests for megabank recklessness that parallel those we see in laws that punish reckless driving and driving under the influence. And the structure of individual punishments should parallel those used in enforcing traffic law. A point and fine system that reflects the severity of particular violations, an effort to deal with repeat violators in extreme cases going to the courts. Now let me just pass through the idea that we're told by people in the Department of Justice that it's just too hard to prosecute these cases. Yeah. Well, what does that mean? There's something wrong with the burdens of proof. So the alternate standards of knowledge and case in criminal law include much easier to prove things than we have in the financial fraud law. So the issue is whether what we have to prove what one knew, or we merely have to prove what one should have known from the climbing up the ladder of mega banking. So in prosecuting impaired or reckless driving, the should have known standard is ruthlessly applied. I like to say, you know, I'm of Irish extraction, and 0.08 alcohol does not impair me. But I have to put up with the fact that we've got this standard. I have a friend who won beer and he was out of control. So, I mean, but we do have a standard, it's enforceable, and that is what we need in the financial area as well. So we need outcome-based, bright-line, prima facie standards for recklessness, negligence, and bailout expense has to be established. Now, this is the last cartoon I'm giving you. I skipped some of it because there just isn't enough time. But what kind of stock options should reckless megabank CEOs and risk managers face? And this is what I say: put them in stocks. Expose them to criminal penalties. Well, so thank you very much.
Conference 25 years ago, by the way, and I think I've been to about half of them over time. It is indeed an honor to be on this panel, first with someone from the Times who actually writes about banks and bank regulation, and then with two of the leading lights in bank regulatory economics. A fair question is, Ed has already raised it, why in the aftermath of the last crisis was most of the remaining regulatory supervisory responsibility for banking and financial services generally, why was that given to the Federal Reserve? Had their prior supervisory efforts, or lack thereof, hadn't those failed spectacularly? Wasn't it rewarding failure in the Dodd-Frank Act in 2010 to hand increased responsibilities and powers to the Fed? I think the authors of Dodd-Frank, the staffs who worked on it, would defend it at least in part by saying, well, yes, we gave additional responsibility to the Fed, but we built in more politically accountable checks and balances than had existed before. So, for example, on reform of Section 13.3, the emergency lending provision in the Federal Reserve Act, that's dealt with in Title 11 of the Dodd-Frank Act. In that reform, the entire White House apparatus was dragged in to any approval of an emergency loan going forward, like the ones we saw in the fall of 08. So, for example, the Federal Reserve could initiate a request to have the authority to do Section 13.3 lending, but they have to consult with the FDIC, and I believe that both the FDIC and the Fed have to concur in the recommendation, which is then presented to the Secretary of the Treasury, who may then authorize it after consultation with the President. So in this case, it goes away all the way up to the White House staff, and the Treasury staff. So unlike the last time, you're not stuck with this constant problem: if I don't like what the Fed has done, whom can I vote for or against to express my displeasure? This time or the next time, you will know it's the White House itself. So if you don't like the financial rescue, go vote the existing party out. That would be the recommendation the next time. A fundamental premise underlying Ed Kane's presentation and part of mine is the following. I'm going to read you a brief paragraph that I wrote a little over a year ago that addresses this subject, and I want you to think about it. What are banks exactly? Are they fiduciaries of the public trust? They take in other people's money, promising to manage it prudently and return it to them on demand for checking accounts, at least. Or, when you walk into a bank, is it exactly the same as walking into, say, Charles Schwab or TD Ameritrade and saying, I'm putting my money here, I know it's going into a brokerage account, I hereby give you the power to manage that account, and I want you to make me the most money you can in exchange for my money. In that case, you have assumed some of the risk of the investment banking operation that the brokerage firm itself will be engaged in. What are you doing when you go in and open a bank account? All too often in the last few decades, the federal authorities, in some cases the state authorities years ago, behave as though your contract with the bank is along the lines of that brokerage operation, but they, the regulators, are going to give the brokerage the same deposit insurance and lender of last resort and payment system access guarantees that they give to traditionally insured banks. So there's a confusion that I think my colleague Mr. Kane would say is intentional and induced by those running the system. They don't want you to think clearly about these things. Does the bank have an obligation to give back to me the money I entrust to it, plus whatever interest rate yield we have agreed upon contractually at the beginning, if that is applicable? Versus the bank says, hey, you know, investment is risky, stocks go up, stocks go down, and we'll give you back your fair share of whatever you have entrusted to us. Which is it? My view, and I think it's your view also, and Randy's too, that in 1998-99, as the push to eliminate the traditional Glass-Steagall Act, dating back to 1933, the Glass-Steagall Act separation of investment banking from traditional commercial banking, deposit-taking, payment system stuff, that this was a mistake, that elimination of Glass-Steagall. There was some effort to bring back the elimination of Glass-Steagall in connection with the Dodd-Frank Act. Did it pass? No. What did we get instead? We got a milder version, which was to be called the Volcker Rule, named after Fed Chairman Paul Volcker, whose basic view was banks should not be using taxpayer-funded insured deposits or insured deposits themselves to place investment banking bets on investment portfolios. And above all, banks should be required to trade for their own account using bank equity holders' funds as opposed to any other deposit or brokerage funds. Even if you had a brokerage account at a modern bank, are you authorizing the bank to place bets for itself using brokerage money without giving you any of the increase? But all too often, that is what they were doing. Ed has summed this up in the bailout context in prior speeches and articles by saying, essentially, the taxpayer is asked to take on the investment banker's risk with regard to large modern banking organizations. But for investment banker's risk, there should be investment banker's reward. What do investment bankers typically get in such a deal? Equity kickers, don't they? They get some promise of a compensation that if the transaction prospers, the banker will gain a previously defined proportion of the total increment of value. Now we'll come back to the bank. The borrower, whoever is receiving the benefit of the financial transaction from the bank, of course, would be entitled to his share of the risk and the gain, but the investment banker takes the gain. In the last bailout, and in all prior bailout operations over the last 30, 40 years, where was the investment banker's gain for the taxpayer? Wasn't there. Now, there used to be investment banker's gain. Let me roll backward to the 1930s for a moment. The main rescue device that was used in the 1930s for the banking system was not the Federal Reserve. Section 13.3 had indeed been put on the books in 1932 as part of an early form of economic stimulus package to authorize the Federal Reserve to deal directly with individuals, partnerships, and corporations, but not with banks. That wasn't really covered in the statute. And then when the bank holiday of 1933 arrived, March of 33, all the banks were closed. It was clear something new was going to be needed to get the banking system going again, something in addition to just the new institution of deposit insurance. So the Reconstruction Finance Corporation was organized, headed by Jesse Jones, and the old RFC took it upon itself to reorganize the American banking system, among other things. It was sort of the role model for TARP, but I think if Jones were still around, he would disown anything and everything done by TARP as a very poor imitation of what he would have done in similar circumstances. Jones typically would approach a bank in a community or the group of bankers in a community and say, look, we've examined you all. They did examine everybody during the holiday, by the way. The holiday was not just everyone goes to Florida for a week. While the banks were closed, every bank examiner in the United States was rounded up and sent into a bank somewhere. Every bank in the United States was examined during that week so that Jones and others back in Washington would have an idea about the solvency situation in the bank pending reopening of some kind. So they divided the banks into three categories, A, B, and C. Category A was banks that were clearly solvent after inspection and could be licensed to reopen as soon as the restriction was lifted. Category B were banks that were perhaps a little short of being fully solvent, but were close enough with assistance that they could survive. If Jones would typically go to the bankers in the community and say, if you want to save your bank, I want you to raise an amount equal to, say, 10% of the total liabilities of the bank, and that'll essentially constitute the recapitalization. If you'll do that, we'll put in up to another 10%, and with that new capital insertion, the bank can probably make it through into ongoing prosperity. Many American banks were saved that way. In fact, I believe the ratio was that out of all the banks that survived the closing, about half of them received assistance of this type from the RFC. And then the third category, category C, was those that were more or less hopeless. Jones said, I'm going to cut off the lending, the combined private and federal lending, at the 25% insolvency level. If you're more than 25% insolvent, you're hopeless and you need to be put in the pathway to liquidation. So out of the 18,000 or so banks that existed before the holiday, 12,000 reopened, half of them with this new assistance. Well, how much does that sound to you like what was done in the fall of 2008? Or March 2009, when it still could have been done? Was it that nobody in Washington knew anything about this story? No, they all knew about it. I assure you that the law firms and senior lawyers at each of the big banks knew exactly the story I have told you, because I have personally discussed it with most of them in years past. So it's back to what Ed was saying. We know what ought to be done, but we simply don't want to do it. It's too painful to us personally and to our portfolios. So there was another thing that Jones used to do with the RFC that would be applicable to the recent problems and to some of the panel discussions we've already had at this conference. It has been noted several times that there's a tremendous burden on the average household in America today. In many cases, not all certainly, but in many cases, because what I'll call legacy debt from 2008 was never restructured properly. Both through the RFC and through other changes made in the 1930s, legacy debt of that time was restructured. The Homeowners Loan Corporation, for example, was created to help homeowners refinance their homes. And they didn't have 25-page application forms, fill them out in triplicate to qualify. They basically said, look, you bring us your note. If you're anywhere within shouting distance of being current on the note, and if you can show me income statements or whatever that would show that over a 10 or 15 year period, you could pay off a mortgage note. We will refinance your house on an amortizing basis for a term of up to 15 years at fixed rate. Such mortgages had not existed before in the United States. It was not at all uncommon for the longest mortgage term to be 5 years, and there were always balloon mortgages without amortization. Okay. What happened to all those floating rate mortgages in my hometown of Cleveland? The poor working and working people took out in the period 04 to 07 with initial teaser rates of 3%, resetting after 3 or 5 years at 9 or 10% or higher. I've seen 12% mortgages. Were they refinanced? Well, no, because under the new standards of all the federal programs that have come out since the Obama administration came in, you had to be reasonably current. There was no real talk of doing a permanent refinancing. You can get into a program and maybe it'll last 3 or 5 years and then you have to go out and refinance yourself again. Doesn't really solve the problem. So things needed to be done about restructuring homeowner debt that were not done. From a bank regulatory standpoint, what other problems are cropping up there on the out there on the horizon? Car loans, they've come up a couple of times this conference. When I was young and growing up, car loan terms were deemed extraordinarily long if they were 3 years. I remember when the four-year new car loan came along in the late 80s, early 90s, and that was considered a risky innovation. But cars improved. You can keep a car now much longer than you used to. We had to buy a new car 2 years ago, and they were offering us five-year car loans on the new ones at that time. Does anyone know how long the car loan term is commonly offered by the dealers today?
7 or 8.
7 years. All right. What do you think about that? What's going to happen, by the way, to the typical car in year 4, year 5? It's going to need repairs, right? And you still got to make the car loan payment. Is this setting up a system of car loans that's designed to fail? What, if anything, has the Federal Reserve done about it? What has any of the federal regulators done about it? The auto dealers like it. Helps them move cars. The manufacturers like it. Helps them produce cars. The auto unions like it. They get to build cars. As a taxpayer, do you like it? Student loans. Okay? I got out of law school in 1974, and I think I had $5,000 of student loan debt. Okay? You could go to law school fairly cheaply back then. I paid it off in 5 years. What do young lawyers graduate from law school owing these days? I think the going in bid is the ballpark of $100,000, right? And medical school and other such things, forget it. Even undergraduate education, the average undergraduate loan now is, I think, somewhere in the ballpark of $20,000. That's a lot of money for someone struggling to get started in a career, get married, have children, buy a house, even buy a car. It's a lot of money to come up with at those income levels. what did we do about restructuring student loans in the aftermath of 08? Nothing, as far as I know. I think the main thing was that a lot more loans were taken from private lenders and put onto the federal government's books. Am I right about that? But the terms the federal government was offering offered little or no relief. My daughter had the misfortune of graduating from college in 2005. What do you think the interest rates are on her loans?
5.5. 6
for the low one, 9 for the high one. Okay, the loans were taken out back around 01, 02, 03. Can she get those loans refinanced? No, they can be consolidated with others and maybe lower the high loan rate average, that maybe the blended rate is, say, 7 or 7.25 now. But isn't that ridiculous in terms of where we are? And yet we complain about the burden on the average working class fellow in the current economic system. So, what, and one final element of the Jesse Jones story that applies to the current situation, then I'll move on. Another thing that Jones did in restructuring American banks and other industries was to examine the quality of management at the time. Whenever you, the corporation, went in to receive RFC assistance, Jones would ask for letters of resignation of the top three officials of the borrower. And he would say, I may not act on these, I probably won't, but I think you'll behave more prudently going forward knowing that I have these. Now, wouldn't that have been a Jim Dandy thing to have in the pocket of an honest regulator back in fall of 08, if it would have gone a long way to resolving the bonus and salary problems that emerged as soon as the TARP money started being dispensed. Remember that? How the AIG guys all paid themselves bonuses? So removing management was serious stuff, and they did do it. How many bankers, senior bankers, were removed by either the Fed or TARP in the aftermath of the 08 crisis? Kane brought it up yesterday. There was only one, Kenneth Lewis at Bank of America. Okay, now do you think he was the sole miscreant in the entire American banking universe? And on the other assisted industries, remember the car industry got some bailout money too. They did remove the chairman of General Motors, okay? But he was the only other senior CEO type that was removed under the federal assistance programs. So what are the elements of a proper bank regulatory structure? Ed has talked about a lot of them. First, you got to decide what are banks in the first place. I wrote that banks either are or should be fiduciaries holding the public's funds as a public trust. Those who want to participate in the risk-taking assets of banking either are or should be shareholders of those banks. If the government is called upon to share the risks of banking, especially the risks of investment banking, then the government should be a shareholder. What Jones did to put into effect that part of the program was, whenever a company or a bank borrowed money from him, he said, I want a warrant convertible into a share of your common voting equity for each dollar that I lend you. Over a great deal of banker resistance, a similar concept was built into TARP, But does anyone recall what the ratio was under TARP? How many warrants did the government get for money lent? The ratio was $6 of loan equals one warrant. Jesse Jones said one for one. And you had to pay him back in 10 years, at which point the warrants became convertible. So it was an additional incentive to those borrowing. If you don't pay me back in 10 years, I'm going to own the majority of your stock. Okay? This time around, bankers said, hey, no worry, they'll never own a majority. The most they can get is about 1/6 or less. So those are some of the elements. Restructuring the debt, the legacy debt, is very important. We haven't done that yet. I hope we do it the next time, if as and when there will be a next time. I'd like to do it tomorrow morning because there's just enough legacy debt left, so it's still a drag on the recovery, I think. And you'll see that more strongly if you visit places like Cleveland and Buffalo. And that's sort of the long and the short of the regulatory tale. Specific issues with emergency lending, with Dodd-Frank and its aftermath, how they fixed up Section 13.3, et cetera. I summarized that by saying, in previous writings, by saying, I think Dodd-Frank was a major improvement over the previous situation. I personally would have preferred that Section 13.3 be repealed outright. Get that out of the Fed. Because it basically is just a parallel operation for what in the 30s was the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, or what in 08 became TARP. By its inherent nature, emergency lending of that type is fiscal policy, not monetary policy. It should be done by the Treasury, either directly or through an agency accountable solely to the Treasury. The Treasury should be fully accountable for it, politically and otherwise. And by putting it over in the Fed, you're just muddying the waters and confusing things a bit, so it makes it harder for people to follow the trail. Dodd-Frank improved the existing situation, but I think it is at best a halfway house on the way to the thoroughgoing reform of the whole emergency lending structure. And it probably will take yet another crisis, yet another round of bailout lending and the subsequent failures before people will finally say in Washington, okay, we finally get it, we've had enough, we'll actually reform the system in the direction it should have gone, which was essentially on that point at least recreating the playbook from the 1930s. And that's about the long and the short of it. So you can see how I'm sort of feeding on and following in Ed Kane's footsteps. Randy Wray and I together and him separately have written things along these same lines in the past, but I'll hold my fire remaining for questions later.
Yeah, I hope you have some questions stored up because after Randy speaks, we're going to hear them, I hope, okay? So write them down and here we go, Randy.
Okay, and you'll notice that my title is not really related to the topic of the panel, so I'm very glad that that Ed and Walker really did cover the topic quite well. I wanted to call your attention to two things that are on the back table. One is a discount order form for my book on Minsky. Princeton University Press contacted me and asked if I could write a book with this title. this was going to be the first in a series of why blank matters, and they chose Minsky to be the first one in the series because of all of the credit he was given for seeing the crisis coming. And the other is Walker was on a Ford project that lasted 4 years that looked at the Fed's response to the crisis, and he presented some of the results from that. And the final report, I think, is on the back table, too, with still some copies left over. So I'm going to be actually returning to the first Minsky conference, and Walker just told you that he was there, and I know that Ed was either that one or the one right after that one. What Minsky would always do at these conferences is set the agenda, and it would be about a 10-page paper that would discuss the topic for the conference. And the first one began 25 years ago. Minsky said, "My aim is to broaden the discourse, to put ideas on the agenda, which are deeper than those that now enlighten the discourse. As the United States struggles with the problem of fixing the financial system, advocates of any particular proposal need to address three questions. First, what is it that is taken to be broken? Second, what theory about our economy works, about how our economy works underlies the proposal? And third, what are the dire consequences of not fixing that which you assert is broke?" The topic of concern at that time was the payment system and the probable insolvency of all of the biggest banks in the United States, and also of the FDIC because of the bank insolvency. And so the question was how to fix our payment system at that time. If we ask the same question now, what is broke today? I'd say the better question is, what isn't broke? The financial system doesn't promote the capital development of the economy, which is really what Minsky was interested in for the whole period from 1990 to 1996 when he died, the period he was at the Levy Institute. This really was the topic of everything that he was doing. He defined the capital development of the economy very broadly. So he didn't just mean private investment in capital. He meant public infrastructure, private infrastructure, and also the skills and training and education of our workforce. Monetary policy today is impotent. At least that's my belief. Maybe there are a few people here who still believe in its potency. But I think that it's been unveiled to be nothing but the Wizard of Oz spinning wheels that are not connected to anything that's important. Money manager capitalism was bailed out and rebooted, as Walker's been talking about. And we appear to be headed full steam toward another crisis. Henry Kaufman yesterday and the whole panel before ours this morning, I think, share that view. Whenever you have a very deep financial crisis, the monetary cranks come out with policy proposals. And I use the term crank not in any negative way. If you take a look at the new Palgrave Dictionary on Economics, they have an entry called Monetary Cranks. And if you read that entry, you'll find out that a monetary crank is somebody who believes that money matters. Because all of us economists know that money doesn't matter at all, right? So Minsky was always a monetary crank. In 1969, he wrote, "Money matters most of the time. At some rare but important times, it's all that matters," okay? And that was, of course, 2007, 2008. "And sometimes money hardly matters at all," and that would have been the early post-war period. After the crash of 1929, people discovered money matters. Although they didn't quite understand what the problem was, they knew that the problem was with the monetary system, okay? The crash that followed 1929. And so the proposals, there are two main categories, I think, of proposals for dealing with the problem that money matters. The first was the 100% money proposal, and the second was Stephanie talked a bit yesterday about functional finance. There actually were two versions of functional finance. There was the Milton Friedman, much more free market approach, And then there was the Ava Lerner, much more Keynesian approach to functional finance. I'll very briefly summarize both of these in just a second. After the crash of 2007, the same thing happened, okay? For decades, economists have been claiming that money doesn't matter, the finance doesn't matter. We had both Modigliani-Miller theorem, and then we had the efficient markets hypothesis. And so money and finance really don't matter. But suddenly we discover again that it really does matter. And we had a turn to two kinds of policy proposals again, 100% money proposals and functional finance. Okay, although different versions from the 1930s. So we have a debt-free money proposal, and we have modern money theory proposal of functional finance. Okay, banking, I think, is broken. There's a common agreement. There is a problem with the banking system. And we have both a too much and a too little view. The too much view is that banks create way too much money. We need to eliminate private lending and return the rights of seniorage to the government. And so we have the positive money movement, mostly in the UK, and we have the greenback movement here in the United States. The too little view is that banks aren't creating enough money. If we just get them to lend more, we could get up on the road to a true recovery. And the QE policy, negative interest rates policy that Scott talked about yesterday, plus broadening acceptable collateral to, I guess, munis, which I thought Walker might talk about, but he didn't get to it today. But this seems to be in the same line that what we need to do is encourage more lending by accepting a broader range of collateral. I'm not really going to talk about the QE and all of that because Scott covered that yesterday. So if we go back to the 1930s, the narrow banking 100% money proposal put forth by Fisher, Simons, and Friedman would have forced banks to hold either reserves of the Fed or Treasury bonds as the asset against the deposit liabilities that they would issue, and this would make banks perfectly safe because they would hold a safe liquid asset. In the 1990s, here at the Levy Institute, as part of these first 2 years of conferences, when we're talking about what to do about the payment system and the problem of FDIC insolvency, there also was a movement again to move toward narrow banking, and Ronnie wrote a book on narrow banking proposals from the 1930s. Today, we have Martin Wolf and Adair Turner both arguing for narrow banking. At the time, Minsky wrote an introduction to Ronnie's book, and I think his position was that these are worth considering, but really what they're doing is fixing something that isn't broke. Okay, I'll come back to that. Friedman wrote a paper that was titled A Monetary and Fiscal Framework for Economic Stability or something like that, in which he combined the 100% money proposal from Fisher, Simon, Friedman, 1930s, with a functional finance approach that was being advocated by Ava Lerner. So we would restrict private banks to 100% reserve banking, which means that they can only issue deposits against very safe treasuries. Fed reserves. All government spending would be financed by currency emission, and that currency would be removed through taxes. The government would no longer issue treasuries. All deficits would be money financed. In fact, all government spending is money financed, but at the end of the year, an amount equal to tax payments would have been removed. So if you run a deficit, you're always increasing the supply of money. If you run a budget surplus, you're always reducing the supply of money. He would have adopted fiscal rules. He said, we will do this democratically. The population can vote what they want the government to do, which could include welfare and Social Security and so on. And then we would set tax rates to make sure that the budget will balance when we achieve full employment. So what this means is anytime there is unemployment, you will be running a budget deficit. Anytime you're beyond full employment, you will be running a surplus. And so you will combine the powers of fiscal policy and monetary policy. You'll be running a deficit and increasing the money supply to get yourself to full employment. So it's a very powerful automatic stabilizer. It's subject to rules, so he still was the good Friedman we all know, rules-based policymaking. If you actually look in detail at this, other than the 100% reserves narrow banking part of this proposal and the fiscal rules part of the proposal, is actually a description, not a proposal. This is actually the way all sovereign governments work. As Stephanie said yesterday, all government spending is always money financed. It's not a policy choice. It's the only way to do it. And so deficits do increase the supply of the government's money, and surpluses reduce it, always. You don't need to change anything. That has already been implemented. There is a problem with it. At the time that Friedman was writing, the U.S. ran current account surpluses, so Stephanie hinted at this yesterday. You actually cannot have a balanced budget at full employment if you run current account deficits, as we do today. So we would have to modify his proposal to say that what we want to do is continue to run budget deficits even at full employment, because we need to cover that current account deficit. So that's the Wingodly sectoral balance approach. Otherwise, the proposal is fine and a description of reality with a Keynesian flavor, except for the 100% money proposal for private banks. If we look at Ava Lerner's approach to functional finance, he combined it with the state money approach. He wrote a paper called Money is a Creature of the State, in which he followed Knapp and Keynes. The two principles of functional finance that Stephanie mentioned yesterday are that if there's unemployment, you need to cut taxes or raise spending. If there's inflation, you need to cut spending or raise taxes. So that is the fiscal component. The monetary component is that if the interest rate is too low, you need to sell bonds to remove reserves from the banking system. If the interest rate is too high, you need to buy bonds in order to put reserves into the banking system. So in other words, as Stephanie and Scott were getting to yesterday, the purpose of bond sales or purchases is to get the right amount of reserves in the banking system to hit your interest rate target. So Lerner understood that bond sales have nothing to do with financing a government's deficits or government spending. It has to do with implementing monetary policy and targeting interest rates. Money is a creature of the state. The state chooses the money of account. It imposes taxes in that unit, and it spends the currency that is used to pay taxes. What this means is that the government can never run out of its own money. Affordability is never the question. The question is inflation. If you have inflation, what do? We have the first law of functional finance. You need to reduce government spending and or increase taxes. Okay, Knapp is usually given credit for developing the state theory of money, which was adopted by Keynes in his treatise on money. But actually, if we want to read one person get the best exposition of the state money approach, you read Innes. In 1913 and 1914, in the Banking Law Journal, he wrote what I think are the two best papers ever written on money. And he combined both the state money approach and the credit money approach into a unified theory. Keynes reviewed that first article in his own journal, the Economic Journal, in 1914, and he said, We might quibble around the edges, but I think Innes has this right. Okay. Let's move on to the modern proposals, positive money and debt-free money. The idea is you want to separate money from lending so that money is going to be free from debt. Here is Martin Wolf. Banks could only loan money actually invested by customers, so not deposits. They would be stopped from creating such accounts out of thin air, and so would become the intermediaries that many wrongly believe they are now. What we want to do is end the franchised seniorage. The government has franchised the banks and given the banks the seniorage power. We're going to take it back to the state. So greenbackers argue that what we're going to do is spend debt-free money, a currency that is not a debt, so that the state will get all of the seniorage that's created by printing up money. This is deja vu all over again. We're going to have debt-free private money, so the banks are not making loans and creating money. And we're going to have a debt-free currency. The government is no longer going to issue government bonds. So this sounds Friedmanian or Lernian. I have argued it's a non sequitur in search of a policy. Debt-free money makes no sense because all money is debt. We've had a little bit of a debate with Krugman. Krugman has argued that Minsky doesn't really understand banking. He said, as I read various stuff on banking, I often see the view that banks can create credit out of thin air. But any individual bank does, in fact, have to lend out the money it receives in deposits. Bank loan officers can't just issue checks out of thin air. Thin air banking is impossible, according to Krugman. And what he has in mind is the deposit multiplier story that someone yesterday said that he had been a student of Minsky in 1962 and said Minsky taught the deposit multiplier in that class. I was Minsky's TA in 1982, 20 years later, and it's true, he taught it because it was in the textbook. But Minsky knew that this was not correct, certainly by 82. And he had handouts for his classes in 1959 and 1960, which are in the archives, in which it's clear that he did not present the simple deposit multiplier as his own idea, anyway. And if you look at his very first publication in 1957, he actually had argued that the development of the Fed funds market was relieving this kind of reserve constraint that the deposit multiplier assumes. Anyway, what did Minsky say? Anyone can create money. The problem lies in getting it accepted. How do they create it? It's out of thin air. It's always out of thin air. And anyone can do it. You sign your name, I owe you $5. You have created money. The problem is it's hard to get it accepted. Bank money, he said, is more acceptable because we all owe the banks. If you owe the bank and you have to pay bank money to the bank, you want bank money. That's why bank money is much more widely acceptable, because all of us, or probably almost everyone in this room, owes the banks. Okay. What do banks do? They make payments for their customers. Loans create deposits. When they make a loan, what is the bank really doing? Do you come in with a wheelbarrow and take cash out to go buy the car? No. They make a payment for you to the car dealer. So bank loaning is really all about making payments for you. How do they make it? Thin air. They credit bank accounts. And then deposits make reserves. Okay? Not in a metaphysical sense, but in the sense that the central bank creates the reserves that are needed if banks need to make payments to one another. So if we want to talk about what is commercial banking and how are commercial banks involved in the payment system, Minsky says, a bank is not a money lender. He used to joke in class, You want a money lender, you go to a street corner in Chicago. There's some guy with a trench coat, and he's got some cash in the pocket, and he will lend it to you, and then he breaks your legs when you miss payments. Those are money lenders. That's not the way the banks operate. So a bank is not a money lender that first acquires and then places funds. A bank first lends or invests, and then funds the cash to cover whatever cash drains arise. If all else fails, they go to the central bank, and the central bank provides high-powered money. HPM happens to be Minsky's initials, so he preferred to call it HPM rather than monetary base, which is what, say, Bruner calls it. Minsky used to talk about the real bills doctrine, and although it wasn't 100% accurate in its description of commercial banking, it was reasonably close. Commercial loans are given to finance economic activity. They are, the deposits are created in the commercial lending business, and that is the main component of our payment system. So you can see how the lending to commerce is what provides the instrument that we use in our payment system. So the commercial lending and the deposits are linked. This is then backstopped by lender of last resort activity and by deposit insurance. Since the central bank targets the overnight rate, it has to accommodate the demand for reserves at that rate. This is what Scott was talking about yesterday. It uses the discount window and open market operations to meet the demand for reserves for clearing. Deposits and reserves accommodate economic activity that requires the loans to begin. So the firms, Walsh and Lauer yesterday was talking about this, that we can conceive of a circuit, and the firms need money to get the economic activity going, and the banks provide that money at the beginning. What broke the banking system? Minsky said in 1992, when we go to the theater, we enter into a conspiracy with the players to suspend disbelief. The financial developments of the 1980s can be viewed as theater. Promoters and portfolio managers suspended disbelief with respect to where the cash would come from. And he wrote a paper with Steve Fazzari, I think in 1982, talking about what was going on in the 80s, the Volcker experiment in practical monetarism, the mismatch of the thrifts. Suddenly the short-term interest rate rises above 20%. They're holding mortgages at 6%. Obviously, they're instantly insolvent. Regulation Q causes disintermediation. They're having trouble financing their positions in mortgages and so on. And so the banks and thrifts move to the originate-to-distribute model in 1987. As far as I know, the first academic to understand how securitization was going to completely change the financial system wrote, "That which can be securitized will be securitized," in 1987, and that came to pass. Everything is securitized, right? We then have the rise of shadow banking. Minsky called it non-bank banks, but it's exactly the same thing that McCulley was talking about. And the rise of money manager capitalism from the 1970s to maturity by 1990. In the early 1990s, this development had led to insolvency of all the biggest banks and of the FDIC, and created the conference series, which you're enjoying now. The global financial crisis that was exposed with a run to liquidity because of the layering of debt on debt on debt, the financial institutions owing each other an amount equal to 125% of GDP, led to the global financial crash. Now, in the UK, they actually had a bank run, Northern Rock, because they didn't have 100% deposit insurance. In the United States, we had no runs on deposits because we have deposit insurance, but we did have to extend the protection to the money market mutual funds because we had allowed them to pretend like they had something equivalent to bank deposits but with no insurance. We had to originate $29 trillion in loans. You can read all about it in the report of our Ford project. And we had to extend and pretend again, just as we had to do in the 1980s, pretend that these guys are solvent. Back in 1975, Martin Mayer had warned, a specter is haunting American business and government, the specter of banking. In 2010, at our Minsky Conference, he said, in past years, loans were funded from the deposit bank, of the deposit base of the bank. Bank deposits are the transaction balances of the economy. Banks had use of this money because they provided the plumbing of the payment system. Their size was determined by the needs of enterprise. The late Hyman Minsky liked to say, there was a morality to the lending officer's work because his prosperity depended on the success of his clients. How far we've come. Goldman Sachs profits depend on duping their customers, right? Having their customers fail because they bet against them. Once the banks could grow by tapping the money markets they controlled, the government was not well equipped or, to be honest, well motivated to stop them. This is what Ed was talking about. What slowed the march of finance was the fact that the profits came at the end of the loan, which had to be financed as long as it lived, inter-securitization, instead of keeping the loans. Okay, we all know this story. Now the money came back to the bank long before the borrower repaid the loan, in fact, before they make the first payments. All these innovations were wildly successful. Their triumph was that the whole world became willing to lend money to instruments, not to business or houses, not to land or labor or enterprise, but to artificial contracts created behind closed doors. The share of the financial sector in profits grew to 40%, the rest of us didn't do so well. So what we have moved to is a payment system separated from production. The banks turned to markets with collateralized lending, relying on credit ratings, treasuries, mortgage-backed securities, maybe in the future, munis. Financialized, leveraged, layered. The financial system's debts to itself, 125%. Getting 20% of value added, 40% of corporate profits. We still have the real bills. We have commercial paper, trade and credit, factor companies, something else we worked on in the early 90s. In the old days, these were held to maturity or they were discounted at the banks. Now they're distributed, securitized, derivatives, squared, cubed, creation of what Jan said a few years ago, fictitious liquidity that suddenly disappears if there's any hiccups. Jan also talked last year or the year before about the rise of alternative payment systems like PayPal. Walmart is going to get into the business, bitcoins, and yesterday Al was talking about iPhones. Mostly unregulated, as Jan argued. Not linked to the production system. And as Al said yesterday, growth requires growth credit and debt with real GDP. But these things are not linked to real GDP. Minsky argued reforming finance requires a proper theoretical framework. In 72, he wrote, one can read almost all of the textbooks and most of the current journal literature without being made aware that the overriding issue in monetary economics is whether capitalism is flawed, in that it's subject to booms and busts. However, this was clearly the concern of Keynes and the Chicago School, of course not Milton Friedman's Chicago School, but the Chicago School of Minsky's time in the 1930s. The critical problem is to create a monetary and financial system which will facilitate economic development, the emergence of democracy, and the integration with the capitalist world. Now he was talking about the formerly socialist countries in the last part of that statement. The narrow banking proposal loses sight of the main object, the capital development of the economy. The key role of banking is lending, or better, financing. The questions to be asked of any financial system are, what do the assets of banks and other financial institutions represent? Is the capital development of the economy better served if the proximate financiers are decentralized local institutions, and should the structure lean towards compartmentalization or broad jurisdictional institutions? I'm not going to go through this. In 2010 at the Minsky Conference, I presented a paper in which I went back to look at Minsky's views on what are the five critical functions that need to be provided by your financial system and various ways that we might supply these. I'll just skip to the bottom. There's no reason why these need to be consolidated in single institutions and no reason why they need to be supplied by private institutions. So the final point I want to make is we need to resuscitate fiscal policy. Stephanie talked about the political roadblocks to doing this, which are huge, of course. If we go back to the post-war period, there's another name I wanted to bring up in addition to Friedman and Lerner, and that is Beardsley-Rummel, who was the chairman of the New York Fed. Some people try to correct me, and they say, no, they call presidents. No, he was called the chairman. And he wrote a paper titled, Taxes for Revenue Are Obsolete. Okay? He said, the war taught us and taught the American public that we don't need taxes for revenue. That's what the war taught us, because we ran budget deficits of 25% of GDP. And so what are taxes for? Not for revenue. And he went through other purposes of taxes, including trying to change people's behavior, okay, sin taxes, and also fighting inflation. So you use taxes to remove income from the private sector, he said, if there are inflation dangers. If you go back, this idea was absolutely understood even before we were a nation. Go back and look at colonial America. It was understood the purpose of the taxes is not revenue, it's redemption. The laws that authorized the note issues, the colonies could not issue coins because Britain retained a monopoly over coinage, so the colonies had to issue paper money. And they realized they needed to create a demand for it. Otherwise, why would anyone accept pieces of paper? So the laws that authorized note issue also authorized new taxes to redeem the notes. And they tried to set the total estimated tax revenue at the quantity of notes they were going to issue so that they would all be redeemed. Just note, the notes have to be issued before the taxes can be paid. So they completely understood that the taxes drive the demand for the notes. And they had to spend first before they could receive taxes. So the creation precedes redemption, which makes sense. You can't redeem debts that don't exist. Bank loans drive demand deposits. This is what Minsky said. He also said taxes drive currency, which was the state theory of money. So what we need to do is think about currency emission by the government as a sovereign power rather than as seigniorage. All governments spend out of thin air to finance government. Banks create money out of thin air to finance business. And I'll stop there. And maybe that will generate.
Thank you very much, Randy. I think, actually, let's go to your questions first before I ask one. Is there anything that was raised in there that you'd like to ask about now?
You mean us or them?
Them.
Does your presentation apply that limited liability corporations don't work for banks and we can't have them?
Well, I'm saying that any bank that has an unlimited guarantee, implicit guarantee from the government, then has this set of equivalent to equity shareholders that's the taxpayers, the citizens, and there even are further problems for the rest of the citizenry, even if they don't pay taxes from the disruptions this causes. So I'm saying we don't have the liability stack right. That yes, there are shareholders, they can have the same rights they have, but
taxpayers deserve rights too.
The essence of a limited liability corporation is to limit the liability.
Well, but
and
we
you're
don't.
Saying it's not limited. So the corporation really doesn't exist.
No, I'm saying no. The corporation exists according to company law. It's a creature of law. And according to company law, the taxpayers are given certain privileges because they expose themselves to total loss. But in fact, for the mega bankers, they're not exposed to total loss. They shift the deep tail of ruination to taxpayers. And this is because the authorities don't have the courage to change the law so as to recognize their own behavior. That they are going to rescue, just like firemen go to fires. They are going to rescue. They see that as their duty. We can't change that, but we can change the capital structure.
Yeah. Let me add on that, sort of bridges these two comments. One is that, remember that prior to the 1930s, banking commonly was done in partnership form, with partners fully exposed to all the losses that their bank might incur. And meanwhile, in the parallel National Bank Act system, until sometime around 1937-38, there was what was called the double call. The comptroller of the currency was authorized to make a call on the shareholders of the bank to pony up an amount equal to the par value of the common stock, which normally was issued at $10 a share. So when you hear that grandpa lost all his money when the bank went bust, you're not being told that he lost his deposits. Those eventually were paid. But what happened was grandpa owned some bank stock and he was subject to the double call and he had to pony up. I believe that J.P. Morgan was the last of the big banks to convert from partnership to corporate form, but there remains today one large-ish private commercial bank that operates as a partnership, Brown Brothers Harriman. And I once had a weekend meeting where the chairman of Brown Brothers at the time was present, and he said, the difference is this way. That I know when I go home at night, if we bet wrong today, I lose the house, I lose the children's college fund, we lose the pony. Meanwhile, those SOBs over at Goldman get to go home at night knowing they get to keep everything they had socked away the day before.
It's possible to think of shareholders as having a guarantee fund that was outside the bank. It wasn't on the balance sheet of the bank. And what we did is replace that guaranteed fund with federal deposit insurance.
I see a question behind.
Peter, when I came into the room, you mentioned, did anybody see the news? And I mentioned that J.P. Morgan had flunked the stress test.
Living wills.
Pardon?
Living wills.
Yeah. Okay, well, has there been a collective latest book, Leaving Wills on the Stress Test? In reading your columns and other columns in many newspapers, there always seems to be a moving target between the stress test and living wills. And has there ever been anything put out by whoever's responsible, you know, central bank or whatever, of what the banks have to do to meet the living wills or the stress test?
I think that's a fascinating question, and I actually may write a piece on it today, and I think it's an important question in the context of what Minsky believed about how the financial system just adapts to new rules so that they can circumvent them. And so if you talk to regulators these days, and I may be giving them too much credence, and I don't know if they're Minskyites, they're probably not, they say, we don't want to make it too clear so that they have trouble complying, and that's the whole point. They have to stay on their toes, and we can move the goalposts if we need to, because you know what? Financial conditions change, risk buildups are in different places. And I would like to just put that to these guys right actually now. It's a good opportunity to do that. Do you think that in Dodd-Frank there is enough flexibility for the regulators to be able to respond in a way that they might actually be able to stop the bankers outwitting them in the future?
No.
Why not?
All you have to do is invent new instruments and say how productive and imaginative and creative it is, and immediately you will frame the problem so as the regulators are stopping productivity. So they always give a chance for these things to be tried out. So I always say that the regulators are outgunned, outcoached, and always playing from behind. They don't understand these new instruments when they first come out. Of course, the people introducing them do. And then they don't get good data on them for quite a long time. And then if they have some really good person working for them who understands it very well, that person is poached for the industries. It's a losing game.
To answer the question a little more directly, Dodd-Frank explicitly gives the regulators the power to require living wills. What was the motive? And the motive was, going back to the beginning of the crisis, when the Fed and Treasury started proposing loans not to banks per se, but to bank holding companies, and then eventually other industries, the two main components were, A, they're too big to fail, taxpayer and the public can't stand it, and B, why should they be given the grace of bank insolvency-like proceedings for winding up as distinct from the happy circumstances they would confront in bankruptcy court, where generations of bankruptcy lawyers are waiting eagerly for bankers to walk in the door, because in a common bankruptcy proceeding, banks walk in and say, we are senior creditors, we have security, allow us to remove the prime assets, and all you peasants out there, you'll be fighting over what remains. So I assure you that the bankruptcy bar would love to have bankers on the other side in bankruptcy court. Bankers also know this, they don't want to go to bankruptcy court, so they were saying, please, please, please give us some alternative liquidation measure. And the congressional compromise was, well, we don't really want to give it to you, but at a minimum, we'll let the regulators require you to write a living will, which shows how you can be effectively broken up without a bailout, and maybe parts of you can go to bankruptcy, parts of you will be resolved in some other way. But that's sort of what it's all about. And so far, what is it, something like 18, 19 institutions are required to submit living wills, and Peter told us earlier that only one has passed the Fed's test so far, Citibank, right?
Yeah, Citigroup was determined by both to have passed. Goldman and Morgan Stanley were failed
right.
by one of the regulators, but not both, so it's partial.
Right.
But let me ask Randy, I mean, we have stress tests, we have living wills, we have FSOC, which is supposed to go around the system. We had Richard Bernard here yesterday, his job is to look for these risks, for these new instruments. I mean, they've tried. What gives you this feeling that they won't succeed, other than just a blanket assertion that the bankers are cleverer?
I think that Ed laid it out, that the incentives are not in place, either for good behavior or for good regulation. I will remain skeptical.
I also witnessed this once at a savings bank failure in New York around 1980, when a bunch of savings banks were going down. I was there representing the Fed, which had a loan out to the bank as it was being closed. The FDIC was in charge of running the closing ceremony, and a large bank that shall remain nameless had bought a subordinated note of the credit of the savings bank about to be closed. And what's the position of subordinated debtors in a bank closing or insolvency? They lose it. They're in the same position as a shareholder. So the bank's lawyer, a leading lawyer whom I knew personally, came into the meeting and told the FDIC, you will, of course, take care of our note. And the FDIC said, wait, you're subordinated. Why should we do that? And the answer was, because we're big and powerful and we will sue you. And we have virtually unlimited resources versus those you can muster. And you will find it much more convenient in the long term to do something to take care of our note. So the outcome was the acquiring institution assumed the subordinated note. And the FDIC separately entered into a loss-sharing agreement with that institution so that if they weren't able to make it a go, the FDIC would tacitly funnel the money in. So that's what really happens, Peter, and that's why it's a problem.
Could I just add one thing, which is FDIC is extremely constrained. So we find out every time there's a banking crisis, the problem is they would have to go to Congress and get more funding.
Right.
And so that is why you have to be very skeptical that they aren't just going to...
But isn't there something built into Dodd-Frank that gives them the chance to levy the industry if they run out of money? And
right. So when you're in the midst of a crisis, you're going to raise a tax on banks.
Right.
It doesn't make much sense.
Any more questions from the audience?
Well, can I just make the point that these things are really people problems, and we're trying to solve them with structural change. We're trying to set rules, whereas it really should be about corporate governance in these very special institutions, that they should have obligations to the people that are supporting them in extreme. And it's a matter of being realistic. I mean, the living will and the stress tests, what's their purpose? To quiet critics. To say, we are looking, we are getting ready for problems, but we know, you mentioned moving targets. They have to be moving targets. How can you come up with a living will in a very complex institution in 1 year or 2 years? It's going to take a very long time, even if you are well-intentioned, to come up with a really workable living will. And why do you want to work on your failure? You know, you're trying to make money. Yesterday, everyone was talking about, building the firm, helping it to grow. This is all about dying. None of us want to think about dying. And even, again, being very conscientious,
They've had 5 years to write those wills, however.
I always want to ask if Barney Frank has any questions for these guys about your...
Well, I would say the biggest difference is, I think illustrated by the reference to the 1980s. This is not the 1980s. And this is where I differ very much with Mr. Kane and also with Mr. Wray. You say there would be... The assumption is that we're in the old days when saying you were interfering with productivity and bank political power was very strong. That was true up until recently. The political climate has changed enormously. Your skepticism, Mr. Wray, that if there had to be an assessment on the large institutions, it wouldn't happen if there was in a crisis, it would happen. And the people who wouldn't do it would lose office. I mean, by the way, it's not an option. Peter brought up the point. If there has to be some outlay in federal funds to try and stop the knock-on effects of a failure to pay debt, it is a duty of the Secretary of the Treasury to recover that from an assessment on institutions above $50 billion. And any Secretary of the Treasury didn't do it would be impeached. I mean, similarly, for what Mr. Kane says, this has been the case, although say it's productivity. The political culture has changed very much. Now, I don't know whether it'll still be that way 10 years from now, but the notion that, there are things in there, but there are all these constraints against using them, go in the absolute opposite direction. I think there's more credibility, more credence I give to some of the people who are afraid, like Edward Cunard and Al Scott, even Guyton a little bit. They're afraid that the liquidity improvements that are available wouldn't be used because people would be politically afraid of it. And so that's my major difference here, is this notion that nothing changed in the political system. A whole great deal has changed. The other thing I'll just take serious exception to Mr. Kane's suggestion that the whole purpose of these was just to quiet criticism. We were serious people. We have some serious disagreements. But that impugning of motives is really very unhelpful. Nobody thinks it's a magic bullet. They do, we think, give them some power to try and do some breakups. But nobody was doing anything just to quiet criticism.
Well, I'd like to just, I've read Act of Congress, which is the book you opened the process of the Dodd-Frank Act up to a journalist. And the first thing you did, and you were very proud of it according to the book, was to lock in the small bankers' support. And I just want to say that Dodd-Frank Act and the whole crisis has screwed the small banks because they cannot scale the regulatory burden that the regulators have put on. I understand that isn't your, that was up to the regulators to write the rules. But these rules are very, very hard to, in terms of paperwork and time, for small banks to meet and still be profitable.
First of all, it was hardly the first thing we did. And once again, it was not the first thing we did to lock in the small bankers. Well along in the process, months into it, I made a deal with the small bankers on one issue, not the whole thing, and that was on the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. And the deal was, and it had to do with regulatory burden, we agreed that they would not be subject to a separate examination if they were under $10 billion in assets. They are fully covered and have always been by any rules. So it was hardly the first thing we did, and it was not a major kind of deal. Secondly, I believe, and there is a problem that we did not anticipate. If you look at the law, there are very few regulatory burdens that fall on the small banks. But the problem here is they're getting over-lawyered. And I do believe we have to spend that. A lot of small banks spend a lot of money, apparently, proving that they're in compliance with the Volcker Rule, which is irrelevant to most of them. They don't do the kind of things the Volcker Rule was aimed at. And so Governor Tarullo from the Fed proposed a couple years ago, and I think it was a very good idea, we simply exempt banks under $10 billion in assets, and maybe has to go up some now, from the Volcker Rule. And at a conference I was at, some lawyers agreed, yeah. The smaller bankers, I believe, I understand their fear. And so, yes, I think we could fix that up by making it very clear that there are some rules that don't apply to them, that they don't have to spend a lot of money on. Other than that, the bill, in fact, to the extent that there was any difference in treatment, the smaller banks were favored. We changed deposit insurance, so the bigger banks pick up a bigger share of that than the smaller banks. And Peter Eavis is right. The FDIC is now fully empowered to get all the money they need, both beforehand and afterhand. But I would agree, the smaller bankers, in ways we hadn't anticipated, have imposed on themselves costs that are greater than the law would require. I understand why they're doing it. The lawyers tell them that. The lawyers tell me, well, we don't want to get sued for malpractice. And yeah, I think an exemption on things like the Volcker Rule and one or two others would resolve that.
Okay, I think we're going to go to lunch now. I think Barney Frank's going to give a speech there, and then you can ask him questions. So the spotlight is on him. Thank you very much to the panelists.